welcome everyone to the Public Exposures Symposium. And I'm Jim Miller, and
I'm Minsook Lee. Before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge the sacred land on which OCAD University operates. It's been a site of human activity for 15,000 years, and the land is the territory of the Huron, Wendat, and the Petun First Nations, the Seneca, and most recently the Mississaugas of the Credit River. The territory was the subject of the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Belt Covenant, an agreement between the Iroquois Confederacy and the Confederacy of the Ojibwe and Allied Nations to peaceably share and care for the resources around the Great Lakes. Today, the meeting place of Toronto is still the home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we are very grateful to have the opportunity to work in the community on this territory for this very historic occasion of celebrating the art and activism of Carol Condé and Carl Beveridge.
Yes, and in doing that, their intent from 40 years ago has really not been about individualism and the sort of glorification of individualism. So this the exhibit and this symposium is really about looking at the issues that they engage, reflecting on how they've done it, but also how others do it, and collectively how we can move forward with thinking about these issues. So here we are today, and I'll leave you to introduce.
Yes, so to begin our morning's program, I'd like to introduce to the stage, please, Caroline Langeau, who's the Dean of the Faculty of Liberal Studies at OCAD University. Welcome, everyone. It's with great pleasure that I have been asked to introduce keynote speaker Barb Byers this morning. OCAD University is thrilled to be partnering with Public Exposures to celebrate the collaborative art activism of Carol Condé and Carl Beveridge. In 2010, OCAD recognized their work with trade unions and community organizations in the production of the stunning photographic works that some of which are at 401 with an honorary doctorate. So it is wonderful to be able to host this symposium as a continuation of their legacy. So now to Barb Byers. Barb's long history working in support of social justice and labor parallels Carol Condé and Carl Beveridge's brilliant artworks representing the same. The rich narratives depicted in Carol and Carl's photography, signifying so many facets of the often challenging lives of workers across numerous professions, are well known to Ms. Byers, who began her commitment to social justice movement as a social worker in social services in Saskatchewan. Barb launched her career in the labor movement in 1979 when she was elected shop steward for the Regina branch of the Saskatchewan Government Employees Union. She continued this work, becoming its first elected female president, not just of SGEU, but of any provincial government employees union in the country. She then followed this as Saskatchewan Federation of Labor president in 1988. She was then elected as Canadian Labour Congress Executive President in 2002 and has occupied the position of Secretary Treasurer since May 2014. When I was doing research on Barb, I was kind of astonished at how many different things she's initiated and the kind of legacy that she brings to us today. She was a literacy advocate for over 25 years, and in 1989 she pioneered West, Workers' Education for Skills Training, which was a workplace literacy program. She helped in the development of a summer camp sponsored by the SFL and the Canadian Labour Congress to introduce the sons and daughters of union members to the principles of social justice and the labour movement. In spring 1997, she initiated the Prairie School for Union Women with Saskatchewan Federation of Labour. For 12 years, Barb has represented Canada as one of 14 worker delegates on the governing body of the United Nations International Labour Organization. And she has connections to art and labour. She has served on the board of the Workers' Arts and Heritage Centre and worked towards the Mayworks Festival in Saskatchewan. And she showed support for the On to Ottawa History Society. And in addition, in recognition of her contribution as an important voice in the Canadian labour movement, Barb Byers was named a member of the Order of Canada in 2015. So it's my pleasure to welcome Barb to the stage to speak to us this morning. Thank you.
Thanks so much, everybody. I am very excited to be here. I'm very excited to bring you greetings on behalf of 3.3 million members of the Canadian Labour Congress, workers from coast to coast to coast in this country. I also bring you greetings on behalf of our President, Hassan Youssef, and our Executive Vice Presidents, Marie Clark Walker and Donald Lafleur. And of course, I also like to take these opportunities to bring you greetings on behalf of other groups of workers, the people who are employed by the Canadian Labour Congress, some of which who are artists as well, secretly. So we keep them very busy, but sometimes they do find some time to let their artist out and practicing. But these are members of Unifor and the Canadian Office and Professional Employees Union. So it's important that we talk about all the people that make our work possible. And I too would like to acknowledge the sacred grounds that we are all on here today and our history as well. As I said, I'm excited and I'm honored to be here, and yet I have to tell you that I'm somewhat terrified. Actually make it really terrified. I look out and there's some folks that I've known closely over the years, there's some that I've known off and on over the years, there's some that I just met yesterday, some that I'm going to just meet today. But what I do know from my contacts within the arts community is that you're an extremely skilled, energetic, committed crowd, and that I feel like I should really just be sitting in the audience listening to you and hearing what you've got to say. So, and I also have to tell you that maybe part of my intimidation, not by the arts, not by artists, but maybe the arts, is because I don't feel particularly that I am artistic. I'm still at the very stick person stage, if I'm drawing, and my singing is slightly off key, although I like to do it. I will take part in theater as well from time to time. So in my next life, I have a goal to be an artist. In preparing for today, I really drafted and redrafted my notes. I went after them again yesterday after the Creative Strategies, an incredible seminar day that we had together where people shared what their experiences were and what their hopes and dreams were as well. And then again, another incredible experience going to the gallery last night and seeing Carol and Carl's work, which is you know, it's really different when I see it in a book, which is important, but when I see it on the wall, and of course I now have an idea, like I said, to Dawn and to Carol. What happens to this work after it comes down? To which I was told that they've got to be finding some places in their basement or someone else's basement. So, of course, I have this mind of, well, then why couldn't we set up a arts loaning in labor so that, you know, you could go to actual union offices and say, hey, there's this great artwork and it can be installed in your workplace for the next 6 months or a year, and no, you don't have to buy it even. It would be nice if you contributed something, but what we want to do is have that public exposure. So thank you so much for all of the years of work and all of the development through those years. So my revamping of my notes has also caused me to talk to more people about arts as movement building, to think about workers as artists and artists as workers. And it's also caused me to think about the importance of art in my life in its fullest sense. So I'm just going to give you, this is going to be a smattering of what we could do together, but also why art is important to me. So it's a lot of this will be personal. Carrie Pither, our Director of Communications, when I was talking to her about putting together my notes, I'll have to tell her that I significantly changed some of the ideas she sent. But that's my art. She said to me, your office is full of art. It is the most colorful place in our whole building. You lend art to other people. They're looking at this as being generous. It's just I have no more wall space. And so I have these lovely pieces that I get framed because I'm not going to just have them sit somewhere. And then I think, well, somebody's got to see this. So it's all over the office, which will have, when I decide to retire at some point, that there'll be another whole discussion about how we're going to deal with that. And she said to me, why have you lent paintings to others? And I just thought, well, because people need to see the work that's been done by people in our communities and in communities around the world. And perhaps I had a discussion with Darcy Martin, who many of you know, and we were talking about Bread and Roses last night, and I thought, yeah, really that is part of my inspiration. It really is how I see life. When the line out of Bread and Roses that says, hearts starve as well as bodies, we need bread, but we need roses too. And that's what it really is. I can't do my work without the inspiration of others around, whether that's art in my office, art in my home, live theater that I was introduced to at the Globe Theater in Regina and continue when I can grab performances in various places across the country, songs that obviously motivate me as well, posters and photos, performances at union events, the creative, although sometimes often off-key, song nights at union schools, where union members put to songs and skits their experiences in their course and pass along the key messages of the politics that they've learned together. There are also things that we have to recognize that sometimes we're not paying attention to in terms of our history and our arts. If any of you come into the CLC office, on the main floor and on the third floor, there's a selection of wonderful black and white photos from a variety of places. Tommy Douglas at Maple Leaf Gardens, a religious sister canning for and getting petitions signed on grapes, other people at rallies, other immigrant communities. We actually had somebody who finally got for us an interpretation or a translation of what was written behind a group of workers that we thought was maybe from Winnipeg, but we weren't sure. And sure enough, it was the banner behind them was in Ukrainian, and the first part of it said, "Workers of the World Unite." Funny how that happens. But you know what? We have those photos framed up in our offices now, as well as ones on our floor with railroaders and so on. We have those because we had some staff that when we were moving from our old building into our new building a number of years ago, discovered that these photos were already in the trash bin, the big disposal bin. And people climbed in there and retrieved everything that they could that was of historical value. And then we sort of, in a moment of defiance, I said, we need to frame those so that that can't happen again. So those are, if you ever come to the CLC office, please, don't only take in the pictures, but someday I'm going to write the history. I wasn't one of the people that even knew about it until the rescue had happened. But thank goodness for those people who understood that preserving the images of our past was also a way to reflect our futures as well. So after experiencing yesterday and last night and preparing for today, I realized how much of all of that inspires me to be energized by the struggle that we're all in. I mentioned that at union schools, how many of you have been to union schools? Okay, so you know the tradition that there's a song night and the courses are supposed to reflect what happened in their course and so on and reflect a message on. So I know that they're not professionally performed. So some might say, well, that's not really what we're talking about here, Barb. And sometimes we even have a little bit of resentment in our courses when somebody in a group has a guitar and actually knows how to play a tune and to keep other people on tune. But they do tell a story of what is being learned in those courses. And they do tell a story of what's happening politically at the time. I think one of the things that we did wrong in collecting our history of the labor movement is that we just said, oh, well, those were songs at the schools and then they go wherever and people might keep them and find them in their memoirs later on. But I think we should have kept a dossier of all those songs. Can you imagine the history? Can you imagine the artwork that Carol and Carl could put together by looking at the songs that had been sung at union schools over the years? It would be a grand history of our struggles and what people were taking on. I did keep, by the way, one dossier of songs. I was a brand new activist in 1979. You brought that year up. Brand new activist, didn't really know much about the union movement. Active in my first strike, didn't really know much about strikes either. But I was learning on a very steep learning curve. We were on strike against the NDP government, the Blakeney government in Saskatchewan. We were the first, it was the first general strike of a public sector union provincially. In Canada, and we had a big rally planned for inside the legislature. Now that was in the days when you could actually go inside legislatures and you didn't have to pass through all this security and stuff. And so we wanted to keep the picketers and the people at the rally somewhat entertained, knowing that they would be also dealing with speeches, which are entertaining sometimes. And so what we did was we had a picket carol contest. And we, in true wobbly style, we took the tunes of Christmas carols and changed them so the words made more sense. And so those carols are part of my history. They're part of my arts and culture of this labor movement, my union culture, and still an inspiration of some of the memories of a young activist who really was discovering this movement. So we in the labor and the arts community work together, sometimes formally, sometimes informally, all the time. The labor movement needs the arts and the power of artists, because you can tell our stories in ways that we can't possibly do that. And we struggle sometimes, as all of you know, to find places where we can support each other. Sometimes we struggle to know how each other operates. And I know that that's especially frustrating for people from the arts communities and from community agencies generally, because sometimes it becomes a discussion of money, and that's not really what the artist wants. What the artist wants is to know that their art and the story that we share together is shared. Sometimes the money helps as well. Sometimes unions come to artists and say, well, Don, can't you just put together this video? And like, I need it next week. Could you get this done for us? Or, you know, sometimes we don't give artists the time to do their craft as we would demand in any of our jobs to have the time to do what we do. In labor, we often drill straight to the point. That's another one of the things we have to learn about each other. In the arts communities, I found in the work that I've done with artists is you want people to have the time to reflect and to develop self-awareness. So it's not simply about coming out and saying, hey, here's the message, now do you understand it? Or as Kevin Millsap would say from Next Up, he'd say, you know, that we often do speeches which are yell and tell, park and bark. And now did you get the point? And where what we find is, in the arts community and with labor educators, is what they're saying to labor leaders and have said for a long time is, no, people will come to their conclusions, they just need to come to them in a way that they understand them and that is relates to their lives and self-reflection and self-awareness. We have successes. And we need to celebrate those successes. Now, I was reminded yesterday when we were at the seminar that we have a whole book of successes here, a whole book. And we need to find ways to add to this about the recent work that's been done together, because it gives inspiration to people all across the country. When you share information like this, people say, oh, well, that's interesting. We could do that. I could do that. So art can be and needs to be integrated into our everyday life in the labor movement. Unions and labor centrals have policies on the arts and labor community working together. In some cases, we need to dust them off. We need to update them, perhaps. And we need to inspire both of our communities to do the best work that we can do together. Because the arts has long-lasting value. That's the reality as well. Long after labor leaders' speeches are given at events like this or our many other places, we will be looking at the work of artists. We will be going to plays and dances and seeing videos and seeing all sorts of artistic contributions to the work that we do, and it has much more long-lasting value. In 1985, the United Steelworkers developed a policy of called Going Public, a labor agenda on the arts. Maybe it's time that we all took a look at that, those of us that come again from the labor community and say, what can we do? What needs to be done with this? Because it was comprehensive. It covered those areas of community culture in the arts, like the song fests that I referenced earlier, which really help reaffirm a group's identity and their shared experience and their confidence with their issues. It's those are also things that give people like me who feel that I'm not artistic an opportunity to be creative, for just that little moment to feel that I'm part of the community as well. The steelworkers policy also deals with commercial arts, artists as employees, and the conditions of work that they need to have in order to continue their craft. And again, that's an area that's often not understood. And I think of, in particular, people who will go to people who are professional singers, artists, and say, oh, we're having a rally. You're a singer, can you just come and perform for us? And it's sort of like a bit of an afterthought, but it's also a bit of a, well, you sing, so like, but you didn't really expect to be paid for it. So it's a matter of educating people that this is work. And certainly Vesti Hansen, a woman that who's an artist, a singer in Saskatchewan, taught me that many, many years ago, is that this is her work and it needs to be honored as work. As well, the steelworkers policy deals with the fine arts, those artists and creators who are creating something meaningful to them and who also share our values, and obviously we are celebrating two of those people now, and but there are many people in communities across Canada and beyond our borders that we need to look at that as well and to celebrate their work. The CLC also passed two resolutions in 2014 on working with a vibrant cultural community. We've passed resolutions about recognizing cultural workers, artists as workers. And that means, by the way, when we start having discussions about precarious work, and not to take away from any of the other groups that we're dealing with, we're also discussing the work lives of artists, some of which who will be union members, but some of which will not. But they are all workers. So I believe that the more that workers see artists as workers and the more that artists see themselves as workers, the more those images will be in our lives that will move our discussions of labor and a vibrant cultural community forward. We should also remember in the labor movement that many of our members are artists as well. They may not get to practice their craft on a full-time basis, but that's where their heart and soul is, and that's where they see themselves at some point when they may get to leave the other workforce that they're in. We can celebrate the programs that we've had, like MayWorks, and that continue to remind us that workers are artists, and also remind us of a class presumptions that push us to somehow forget that fact. There are versions of MayWorks in other parts of the country that show our solidarity, that show our shared values. I was reminded of this recently when I saw MayWorks Halifax, a retweet of something that I had tweeted. I thought, oh, I forgot that, you know, when I think of MayWorks, I do think of Toronto, but I don't necessarily think about where it is until I am reminded of that. And there have been attempts at MayWorks organizations in other places, and it was pointed out that we gave it a really good try in Saskatchewan. It was very successful in lots of ways, but we needed to figure out a way to sustain it. So that's one of my lists of projects when the day comes that I retire. Okay, I've added another one to that list of things of, okay, can we get MayWorks started again in Saskatchewan? We have organizations like the Workers' Arts and Heritage Centre that brings together the arts, culture, heritage, workers, to support each other, again, in our shared values and goals. We have organizations like the Alberta Labor History Institute that brings together workers and artists and historians to celebrate our past, our present, and our future. By the way, from the labor movement perspective, they're the first group that I know of in the labor movement that actually 5 years before they celebrated the 100th anniversary of the Alberta Federation of Labor, 5 years before that, they started doing their historical work and bringing in all the various pieces over the course of 5 years. Usually what happens, I'll tell you a secret that you probably already know in the labor movement, we wake up one day and say, oh, it's our 100th anniversary next year. How did that sneak up on us? And then we start to say, well, what would we do? And then we put on an event, which oftentimes is a dinner for the people who are active, instead of figuring out how do we celebrate our past and how do we bring in people of the future. And again, when we look at the work of artists across the country that have contributed so much to the memorials to workers who've been killed or injured on the job, and if you get a chance at some point in your lives, as you go through Canada, try and find out where those memorials are. Some of them are absolutely incredible. I think of a new one that's going to be launched in Whitehorse this year. I think of one in St. John, New Brunswick, that is, they worked with the local sculptors and did incredible work. But again, taking a look at that. We have great examples of when the arts community reached out to labor and called on them not only for financial support, but also to be included. I recall when I was president of the SFL, Ruth Smiley, who is the artistic director of the Globe Theatre in Regina, she reached out to the SFL with an innovative project. Ruth wanted the workers in Regina to see the Globe Theatre as their theatre, as a place for workers, not only for people who that we may have in our minds are the people who go to theatre. And so Glace Bay Miners Museum was going to be one of their projects that year. And would labor consider co-sponsoring a play? So like the big corporations did, would we sponsor a play? We're a small federation. We had to figure out how we were going to do it. But if we could raise the amount needed, we would not only be a sponsor, but each of the unions that were part of that sponsorship would be recognized for a different day on the play presentation. We would have extra tickets for the rehearsal nights to take our members to the Globe, and it would be seen as part of their lives. And it worked. It worked, and it brought in some people who said, I never knew the Globe Theatre was part of showing our stories. I never knew the Globe Theatre was someplace I could go. So it worked for one or two more plays, but again, we had some problems with sustainability, and I add that one to the list of when I retire. But there are all of those sorts of things. I forgot to check out what time I started, so it's hard to know when I'm finished. So I guess I've got five more minutes? Okay. So we can't forget that what we've done together is really an expression of our shared struggles and our values. And it's taught me that art is a very powerful tool for our members and for the public. It's long-lasting, and as I said, it's more long-lasting than the speeches that we give. We need to work together. So I want to just wrap up with this. A colleague and a friend, as I was preparing, passed along some interesting information and quoted John Grierson, a documentary filmmaker, who said, art is not a mirror, but a hammer. It's a weapon in our hands to see and say what is good and right and beautiful. And so the being here today caused me to think about that quote in the relation to the work that we're doing to re-engage our members, to reintroduce or maybe just introduce them to the union movement, and also to do that introduction to the public, to engage in discussions of fairness and the values that the labor movement stands for. So the labor movement looks and acts and feels differently than the stereotype. And so we know that the survival of the labor movement really depends on reaching out to new audiences. So my friend gave me some other stats about the arts, which caused me to think about our work together. These are stats from 2010. If 10 million Canadians visited an art gallery in 2010, or almost 36% of the population, And nearly one half of all Canadians visited a museum in 2010. Are they seeing the work of artists who share the values of labor and social activists? What can we do together to ensure that our values are reflected in the art galleries and museum presentations that workers and then others in the public will see? And what is it about those presentations that is ensuring that we're diverse and inclusive? In terms of the performing arts, if 61% of the population, 17 million Canadians, attended at least one theater, popular music, or classical musical performance, and nearly one half attended a cultural festival or other performing arts event, are we doing everything we can to ensure that the labor and performing arts communities are working together to reflect our histories, our present lives, and our hopes for the future? And again, is the diversity there? If almost 70% of Canadians went to a film or a drive-in at least once in 2010, and 79% or 22.2 million Canadians watched a video, are they watching stories of workers' lives and movements for social and economic justice? And are those stories diverse and inclusive? If 76% of Canadians listen to recorded music on CD, while 51% listen to downloaded music, is that music one that which reflects our histories and our lives again? I told you I love music, I wish I could sing well. I know the artists that tell our stories, that fill my heart up, fill my eyes up, and keep me and give me the courage to keep on going. And I've got a long list of them in here, but I don't have the time. But I want to reflect on a quote I heard last night from Gord Downie from Tragically Hip, an interview he did with Wendy Mesley in 2012. She asked him why he had so many references to Canadians in his music. And he was eloquent, much more eloquent than I, basically saying that those places and situations are a part of who he is. And so we need all the music from all sorts of genres that inspire us and speak to those shared experiences. And we have to know that we have to pay special attention to groups that may not have had their stories told, that may not have had their songs sung. The visible minorities and Aboriginal people who have higher overall levels of active participation, especially active participation in a lot of their arts and cultural groups. Young people under the age of 35 who have a high level of engagement with online art forms. And people who are more connected with their cultural heritage are more likely to be engaged in arts activities overall. So if we're going to reflect our lives and our shared values, then we need to make more space for those experiences and those interests as well. Sisters and brothers, there are stories to be told. There is art to be produced. There is photos to be taken, songs to be sung, theater to be performed that only we can do and we can do together. And we need to support each other. More projects for me. In closing, I want to say, I started out by quoting from Bread and Roses, hearts starve as well as bodies. Well, when I was talking to Darcy Martin last night, getting more thoughts, I thought he said art starves as well as bodies, and which gave me pause to think, and I think both of us to smile. So I think we need to work together very closely to ensure that we do not starve the arts and we do not starve our hearts, for we all need bread and we all need roses too. Thank you for the privilege of being here with you today. I'm in a huge listening mode from this point on, and I'm already inspired from learning from you. Thanks so much.